Okay, good evening all of you students. In last class, we derived the formulas for moment of inertia in case of the uniform rod, thin uniform rod and circular ring. In different cases, we derived the formulas for moment of inertia. Okay, now third one, in case of circular disc, uniform circular disc. In case of uniform circular disc. So in case of uniform circular disc, we have to derive the formula for moment of inertia. Okay, so in this first case, about natural axis, about natural axis of the circular disc, what is the moment of inertia? Natural axis. So here you see, suppose there is a circular disc. Here there is a circular disc. It is the circular disc. Side view of the circular disc is like this. Here it is the center. Okay. So mass of the circular disc is capital M. And radius is say radius capital R. Radius is capital R. About this axis, what is the moment of inertia? That we have to derive the formula for this one. The line passing through midpoint, the line passing through center of the disc and perpendicular to the plane of the disc. That is called the natural axis of the circular disc. So about this natural axis, we have to derive the formula for this. Here the circular disc is not a point mass. The mass of the circular disc is extended entire area. The mass of the circular disc is extended up to the entire area of pi r square. Okay, that's why it is having uniform surface density. Surface density means mass per unit area. Surface density. Surface density is equal to mass per unit area. Mass per unit area, pi r square. That means for unit area of the circular disc, the mass is this one. It is constant. So this is a equation one. Now, how we can find the moment of inertia of this disc about this natural axis? For that, here this disc can be imagined as the combination of number of circular rings. No, this disc can be imagined as the combination of number of circular rings. Okay, you imagine one circular ring like that. That is called circular element. So you imagine a circular element like this. You imagine a circular element like this. It is the circular element. Here the radius of the circular element is a smaller, and the thickness of the width of the circular element is a dr. Width of the circular element is dr. The mass of the circular element is a dm. Circular ring or circular element. Here already in previous classes we derived the formula for moment of inertia of the circular element about the natural axis. No, about an axis passing through center and perpendicular to the plane of the ring. The moment of inertia we derived mass into radius square. No, similarly for this circular ring about this axis, what is the moment of inertia? Means the moment of inertia of the element, say di. Di is equal to mass of the element dm into radius of the element square. That's why that is equal to r square. So what is the mass of the element? Mass of the element means, you see, surface density sigma. No, mass of the element means mass per unit area of the element sigma into area of this element. Surface area of this element means here as the radius of the circular element is smaller, radius of the circular element is smaller, the length of the circular element is equal to circumference 2r into width dr. That's why 2πr into dr is the surface area of the element considered here. No, that's why area 2πr into dr. So mass per unit area into area of the circular element, that is equal to mass of the element into r square. So therefore from this 2π sigma into r square, so r cube into dr, it is the moment of inertia of the circular element considered here. This is a equation 2. Okay, therefore moment here, this disc can be imagined as the combination of number of this type of circular elements from radius small r is equal to 0 to small r is equal to capital R. For each and every this disc can be imagined as the combination of infinite number of such circular elements. For each and every element, we have to find the moment of inertia about the natural axis and we have to add them. That gives the total moment of inertia of the circular disc. But practically, for infinite circular elements, it is not possible to find the moment of inertia. That's why for one circular element here, you find the moment of inertia. And this type of circular elements can imagine from radius small r is equal to capital 0 to capital R. between those limits you integrate, you will get the moment of inertia of the entire disk about this axis. Therefore, moment of inertia of the entire disk about this natural axis is equal to integral moment of inertia of the element. Limits small r is equal to capital R. Small r is equal to 0 to capital R. So this is equal to, here di we had substituted. Integral di means 2 pi sigma into r cube dr. Limits small r is equal to 0 to capital R. So this is equal to 2 pi sigma is constant, no? You write outside. Into r cube dr. R cube dr. Limits small r is equal to 0 to capital R. So 2 pi into sigma means we can write m by pi r square from equation 1. So m by pi into capital R square. Into integral r cube dr means r to power 4 by 4, no? Limits 0 to capital R. So therefore this is equal to pi pi cancel, of course here pi pi cancel. 2 m by r square into, when you substitute upper limit you will get r to power 4 by 4. When you substitute lower limit it becomes 0. Here r square square cancel, then remaining 2 2s are r square, here 1 square cancel, so remaining is r square. Therefore moment of inertia of the circular disk about this natural axis is equal to I is equal to mr square by 2, no, mr square by 2. So this is the moment of inertia of the, it is the moment of inertia of the circular element, a circular disk. It is the moment of inertia of the circular disk. So moment of inertia of the circular disk is this one. Okay, next, here it is about natural axis, moment of inertia of the circular disk. Okay, next, about the diametric axis, about diametric axis, what is the moment of inertia of the circular element? Okay, next, B, about diametric axis, about diametric axis, what is the moment of inertia? Suppose here you see, it is the circular disk, here it is the circular disk. Okay, this is a x axis, here this is a x axis, this is a y axis, it is a z axis. Here this z axis is, this z axis is perpendicular to the plane of the disk and passing through center. That's why this z axis is the natural axis. Z axis is the natural axis. Okay, here this xy axis lies within the plane of the disk. Within the plane of the disk. Here this x axis behaves like a diameter and y axis also behaves like a diameter. That's why about x axis, about y axis, the moment of inertia of the disk are say Ix and Iy. Both are equal, no? Because it is diametric axis, it is also diametric axis. Diametric axis means the line passing through center and lies within the plane of the disk. That is called the diametric axis. So here x-axis acts as the diametric axis, y-axis also diametric axis only. That's why about x-axis, moment of inertia of the disk, that is the diametric axis, or about y-axis, both are equal. That is equal to question mark. Both are equal. Now, according to perpendicular axis theorem, according to perpendicular axis theorem, because the these two axes which are perpendicular to each other lies within the plane of the disk. That's why according to perpendicular axis theorem, perpendicular axis theorem, the moment of inertia of the circular disk about an axis passing through intersection of the two perpendicular axes and perpendicular to the plane of the disk, that is the z axis, no? About that z axis, moment of inertia iz is equal to sum of the moments of inertia of the same body about two perpendicular axes lies within the plane of the disk. That's why that within the plane of the body, that means that is equal to ix plus iy. Iz means it is the natural axis. Z axis is the natural axis passing through center and perpendicular to plane of the disk. About that axis, moment of inertia is mr square by 4. That's why iz is equal to mr square by 2. That is equal to Ix, Iy both are same. So instead of Iy also you write Ix only. Therefore 2 into Ix, since Ix is equal to Iy. Therefore Ix is equal to, about this axis, moment of inertia Ix is equal to I, Iy is also equal to I. Therefore Ix is equal to Iy is equal to I. That is equal to mr square by 4, no? Mr square by 4. So about the diametric axis, moment of inertia is mr square by 4. In this way, we can derive the formula for moment of inertia of the disk about the diametric axis. Okay, this is one more point. Okay, next, moment of inertia of the circular disc about an axis, about tangential axis and perpendicular to the plane of the disc. About the tangential axis and perpendicular to plane of the disc, what is the moment of inertia? Here we see, suppose this is the circular disc. Here this is the circular disc, it is the center and radius is capital R and mass of the disc is say capital M. Here, when we can draw the number of tangents to the circular disc at the periphery. Okay, this is the tangential line. It is the tangential line. It is the tangent drawn to the surface of the tangent drawn at any point on the circumference of the disc. That's why it is the tangential axis. But it is perpendicular to plane of the disc. No, plane lies in this direction. So perpendicular to plane of the disc, this axis lies. That's why about this axis, what is the moment of inertia? That is the question. About this axis, what is the moment of inertia of the disc? Immediately, when you see this axis, immediately we are getting idea that an axis, they are parallel to this given axis and passing through center of mass of the disc. Here, center of mass of the disc lies at the center, no? So about this axis, passing parallel to given axis and passing through center of mass, we know already it is the natural axis. About this axis, moment of inertia, we know. Perpendicular distance between two parallel axes means that is equal to radius of the disc only, no? So you apply the parallel axis theorem. So according to parallel axis theorem, moment of inertia about the given axis is equal to sum of the moment of inertia about an axis parallel to given axis and passing through center of mass IZ plus mass of the body into the square of the perpendicular distance between two parallel axes. It is the formula. Now you apply here, IZ means moment of inertia about an axis parallel to given axis and passing through center of mass or center of gravity. That is equal to, what is the formula? It is the natural axis of the disc, no? About the natural axis of the disc, moment of inertia is already we derived, mr square by 2. That's why you write mr square by 2 plus m into. Here the perpendicular distance between two parallel axes are, that's why you write r square. R square is there. Therefore, I is equal to, when you simplify them, you will get 3 mr square by 2. No? It is the moment of inertia of the circular disc, about the tangential axis perpendicular to the plane of the disc. Okay, next. D. About tangential axis and parallel to plane of the disc. What is the moment of inertia? So here you see, this is the circular disc. It is the circular disc of radius capital R, mass capital M. Here, suppose you draw a tangent. Here, disc lies within the plane of the board. So you draw a tangent to the at the circumference so that the axis lies within the plane of the disc. So this is the tangential axis lies within the plane of the disc. No? About this axis, what is the moment of inertia? They asked. So immediately we had to get idea that the axis passing through center of mass or center of gravity parallel to this axis means this is the axis parallel to given axis and perpendicular passing through center of mass or center of gravity. No? Okay, about this axis, moment of inertia we know because it is the diametric axis of the cylinder, this disc, that is equal to mr square by 4. No? About the diametric axis of the disc, the moment of inertia is mr square by 4. So about this axis, what is the moment of inertia means? Here the perpendicular distance between two parallel axes is equal to small r equal capital R. No? Now according to parallel axis theorem, moment of inertia I is equal to Iz plus m into small r square. No? Iz means parallel to given axis passing through center of mass, moment of inertia is mr square by 4. Plus m into perpendicular distance between the two parallel axes are capital R. That is R square. Therefore, I is equal to 5 mr square by 4. We can write now. 5 mr square by 4. It is the moment of inertia about this axis. So in this way, we can derive. Next, one more. About an axis. lies within the plane of the disk. Within plane of the disk. What is the moment of inertia? So we have to derive the formula for this. Here you see, this is the disk. This is the circular disk. Center is this one, and radius capital R, mass capital M. Okay, about this chord, about the chord, about an axis means it is a chord also. Chord. About the chord lies within the plane of the disk. About this chord or about the line lies within the plane of the disk. What is the moment of inertia? So immediately, parallel to given axis, about this axis, we have to find the moment of inertia. Parallel to given axis, passing through center of mass. That means this is the diametric axis now. About this axis, moment of inertia is Ig. That is equal to diametric axis means mr square by 4 only. What is the moment of inertia? Suppose here this given axis is parallel to an axis passing through center of mass and parallel to this one. The perpendicular distance here is say x. Then about this axis, moment of inertia I is equal to. Now Ig means about this natural axis, moment of inertia is mr square by 4 plus mass m into square of the perpendicular distance between two parallel axes means x square. No, so this is the moment of inertia of the disk about the chord. About the chord. About the chord. Okay. So in this way, we can derive the formula for moment of inertia in different cases. Of course, one more point is also there. Next case. So. In next case, moment of inertia of the part of the disk. Moment of inertia of part of the disk. Part of disk in the form of sector. Part of disk about an axis. About an axis passing through center. Passing through center and perpendicular to the plane of the sector. Plane of sector. So about this axis, moment of inertia we have to derive. Moment of inertia formula we have to derive. Here actually you see. Actually this is the circular disk like this. The remaining part is removed, and about this for this sector only, what is the moment of inertia they asked. Mass of the sector is capital M, not disk. Mass of the sector, it is the center. It is the center. Okay, so here okay, it is the part of the disk which is called sector. Okay, this is the sector. The center of the sector is this one. About an axis passing through center and perpendicular to the plane of the sector, what is the moment of inertia? The angle made by this sector at the center is say theta. That will be given. Okay, angle made by the sector at the center is theta. Then what is the moment of inertia for this? Here actually total, suppose if it as it is a part of the disk, total mass of the disk, you imagine. Of course different methods we can do. One method, easy method, is total mass of the disk. Total mass of disk is equal to say capital M naught. Mass of the disk is M naught. The disk subtends an angle 2 pi radians at the center now. So the total mass of the disk which subtends an angle 2 pi radians at the center, the mass of the disk is m naught. Then what is the mass of the mass of sector which makes 1 radian angle at the center? Mass of the sector which makes or which subtends, which makes a radian angle, radian angle at center. A radian okay, mass of the sector which makes a radian angle at center is equal to m naught by 2 pi no. Mass of the sector which makes a radian angle at the center is this m naught by 2 pi. For here, this sector makes an angle theta. Therefore, mass of sector, mass of given sector is equal to. Here the mass of the sector which makes one radian angle at the center is equal to m naught by 2 pi. Because the entire disk makes an angle 2 pi at the center. So per unit radian, what is the mass of the sector means m naught by 2 pi. If the angle made by the sector at the center is theta, what is the mass? So that is given as m in the problem. That is equal to m naught by 2 pi into theta. No, m naught by 2 pi into theta. This is one. So from this mass of the sector, the mass of the entire disk in terms of given mass, mass of the entire disk in terms of given mass is equal to. Okay, see, this is the mass of the given sector. Therefore, mass of the given disk, entire disk, if it is there, is equal to 2 pi m by theta no. This is equation 2. Then what is the moment of inertia? Moment of inertia of the entire disk about this, suppose if the entire disk is there, moment of inertia of this entire disk about natural axis is equal to say I naught. I naught is equal to mass of the disk m naught into radius square by 2 no. About natural axis of the entire disk, moment of inertia is I naught is equal to this one. Here, this disk, about the natural axis, the entire disk, moment of inertia of the entire disk is equal to m naught r square by 2, which subtends an angle 2 pi radians at the center. Then what is the moment of inertia of the sector which subtends an angle 1 radian at the center? 1 radian at the center means m naught, of course, I naught by 2 pi. This total moment of inertia is the moment of inertia of the disk, entire disk, which subtends an angle pi 2 pi radians at the center. For unit radian, what is the moment of inertia of the sector? That means I naught by 2 pi. For theta angle, what is the moment of inertia of the sector? So this is equal to I, which is equal to I naught means we can write m naught r square by 2 into theta by 2 pi. That is equal to m naught means 2 pi m by theta into m naught r square by 2 into theta by 2 pi. So here 2 pi cancel, theta, theta cancel. Okay, next some r square is also there, no? Okay, so remaining is here. M naught means 2 pi m by theta. M naught is not there, no? Because M naught means 2 pi m by theta we have written. 2 pi m by theta into theta by 4 pi is there. Okay. Theta by 4 pi. Here this M naught is not there. Instead of M naught, we have written 2 pi m by theta. Okay. By 2 is there into r square into theta by 2 pi. Okay, 2 pi cancel. Then we got I is equal to m r square by 2, no? Where m is the mass of the sector only, r is the radius of the sector. So about an axis passing through center and perpendicular to plane of the sector, what is the moment of inertia? Means simply m r square by 2, where m is the mass of the sector, not mass of the disk. Even if the mass of the entire disk is capital M, moment of inertia about the natural axis is equal to m r square by 2 only, no? Even for the sector also, if the mass of the sector is m, moment of inertia about an axis passing through center and perpendicular to plane of the sector is also equal to m r square by 2 only. Okay, so in this way we can do. Okay, next, moment of inertia of the remaining disk. Suppose here, moment of inertia of remaining disk. Suppose here we are given one disk, circular disk of radius capital R, center is O, and radius capital R, mass capital M. Okay. About the diametric axis, moment of inertia is say I1. Okay. Here from this disk, suppose whatever I1 is equal to, it is the diametric axis now. About the diametric axis, moment of inertia is mr² by 4. About the diametric axis of the disk, moment of inertia is mr² by 2. About the diametric axis of the ring, moment of inertia is mr² by 2. As it is the disk, mr² by 4, we have to write. This is equation 1. Now, from this disk, a small circular disk is removed. Small circular disk is removed from one side of radius smaller. So when this part is removed, then what is the moment of inertia of the remaining part about the same axis, they may ask. Okay. So here, suppose if I2 is the moment of inertia of the removed part about the given axis. I2 is the moment of inertia of removed mass from given axis. Removed mass about the given axis. Moment of inertia of the removed mass about the given axis. Here you see, moment of inertia of the removed mass about the given axis means, suppose the mass of the removed part is say small m. Okay, this removed mass is center of the, here, in case of removed mass, radius is smaller, mass is say small m. Or mass is say m naught. Then, moment of inertia of the same removed part about the same axis you find, that is say I2. So, what is the moment of inertia of the remaining part means, you have to subtract the moment of inertia of the entire disk without this removed mass, without the hole here about this axis. Then you subtract the moment of inertia of the removed part about this axis. Then that gives the moment of inertia of the remained part. Okay, therefore, moment of inertia of remained part, comma, I is equal to, okay, moment of inertia of the entire disk, total disk, without hole, minus moment of inertia about the same axis, moment of inertia of the remained part about given axis is equal to moment of inertia of the total disk about the given axis minus moment of inertia of the removed part about the given axis. Total moment of inertia of the total disk without hole about the given axis. Here it is, about given axis. Therefore, I is equal to moment of the inertia of the entire disk without hole about the natural axis or given axis is I1 minus moment of inertia of the removed part about this axis is I2. This is the formula. How we can find I2? Moment of inertia of the removed part about this axis means, parallel to this axis, passing through center of mass of the removed part. We know the moment of inertia about this axis, m naught square by 4 about this axis. Okay. Mass means mass per unit area of this entire disk is mi pi r square. For this area, what is the mass? That is equal to m naught. We can find. Then, by parallel axis theorem, we can find the moment of inertia of the small disk removed part about this axis. We have to substitute that value there. So, in this way, we can find the moment of inertia of the remaining part. It was once given in advance. Okay. Okay. Moment of inertia of the hollow sphere. Okay. In this, there are different cases about natural axis or diametric axis. Means, in case it is a hollow sphere of radius capital R, mass capital M, say. The mass of the hollow sphere lies only on the surface of the hollow sphere only, no? The line passing through center of the hollow sphere, it is called the diametric axis or natural axis. So, about this axis, what is the moment of inertia? That is the case. As the mass is distributed only on the surface of the hollow sphere here, so, we can imagine this hollow sphere as the combination of number of circular elements. You imagine number, it is made to number of slices like this. Each and every slice behaves like, appears like a circular ring. That's why here, you see, you imagine the circular element like this. Just imagine one slice, number of slices like this. You remove one slice and you see, that is a circular ring, you know. That's why this hollow sphere can be imagined as the combination of number of circular rings like this. Number of circular rings. Okay. Here, the radius of the circular ring, here this radius of the circular ring is say small x. Here radius of the circular ring is say small x. Okay. Angle subtended by this width of the circular ring at the center means you join the two edges of the circular element. This angle subtended is d theta at the center. Angle made by this circular element with horizontal, this line is a theta. So from the horizontal line, at an angle theta, one circular element is considered whose width makes an angle d theta at the center. Okay. Now, here you see, this width is equal to arc of the circle. No? This width is equal to dr. This width is equal to, say, dr. This width is, say, dr. Dr. Or you say dx. Okay, dr, you take. Width is equal to dr. Okay. Now, mass of this element considered is, say, dm. Okay, now, as the mass of the hollow sphere distributes only, resides only on the surface of the hollow sphere, it is having surface mass density. So, surface mass density. Surface mass density. Comma, sigma is equal to mass of the entire hollow sphere by total area of the hollow sphere, 4 pi capital R square. It is the mass per unit area of the hollow sphere. Okay, then what is the mass of the element considered here? Mass of the element dm is equal to, mass of the element considered here is dm, which is equal to, you see, the total length of the circular element is equal to, as the radius is x, that is equal to 2 pi into x, no? So length of the circular element is 2 pi into x, 2 pi into x. Width is say, width is say dx, you, because it is taken as x, no? So width is say dx, width is dx. So width is equal to dx. Okay, now this is the area of the this element considered. Okay, into sigma. For unit area, if it is the mass for this much area of the circular element, what is the mass means 2 pi x dx into sigma, no? 2 pi x into dx into sigma. Okay. Okay, here, of course, here the width of the element. Here mass of the hollow sphere is say capital M. Width of this element considered is, this is a dl. Width of the element is a dl, which subtends an angle d theta at the center. That's why here, instead of, because x we imagine here, here this length is x. It is not this in this direction. That's why you take this as dl. Okay. But from the diagram, how we can write x value in terms of capital R? Because radius is capital R, no? If it is theta, then this is equal to theta. If it is theta, then R cos theta is equal to x, no? From the diagram, cos theta is equal to, here if it is theta, this is equal to theta. This is theta. Then cos theta is equal to x by hypotenuse means R. So x is equal to R cos theta, we can write, no? So 2 pi into x means r cos theta into sigma into whatever dl. You see, angle subtended by this arc at the center is equal to d theta. So d theta can be written as arc by radius. Arc by radius. So dl can be written as r into d theta. No? This dl can be written as r into d theta. Therefore, here 2 pi capital sigma into capital r square into cos theta d theta. This is the mass of the element. Okay, here this mass of the circular element. So here this is the axis passing through center of the circular element and perpendicular to plane of the circular element or ring. No, that's why moment of inertia of the circular element about the natural axis is equal to mass of the circular element into radius square. Radius square means x square. So dm means 2 pi sigma r square cos theta into d theta into x square means x is equal to already r cos theta, no? So r cos theta whole square. Therefore, 2 pi sigma into, here r square is there, r to the power of 4, cos theta, cos square theta. So, cos cube theta into d theta. So, this is the moment of inertia of the circular element. Here, this type of circular elements can be imagined from this direction to this direction. So, from this line, from minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2, this type of elements can be imagined. That's why between minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2, integrate them. So, therefore, total moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about this diametric axis or natural axis is equal to integral di between the limits theta is equal to minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Okay.
Okay. Here, this is equal to 2 pi, you can write 2 pi, the constants you can written outside. So, you write constants outside the integration. 2 pi sigma r to the power of the constants. When you consider the different elements, this angle made by the different elements, this line changes, partial line changes. That's why theta is only here. That's the integral cos cube theta into d theta. We can write. Okay, this is equal to 2 pi sigma r to the power 4 into integral theta is equal to minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Cos cube theta can be written as cos square theta into cos theta into d theta. Okay. So here I is equal to 2 pi sigma. Sigma means we can write m by 4 pi r square. M by 4 pi r square into r cross 4 into integral. Cos square theta can be written as 1 minus sin square theta into cos theta into d theta. Okay, this is equal to, you see, 2 pi uza r square cancel. Therefore, I is equal to mr square by 2 into integral. You multiply with cos. Cos theta minus sin square theta into cos theta into d theta. Limits of theta is equal to minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Okay. So here, I is equal to mr square by 2 into integral of cos theta means d theta means we can write sin theta minus integral of sin square theta cos theta that can be written as sin cube theta by 3. Limits theta is equal to minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Is it correct or not? In order to verify them, you differentiate the sin cube theta by 3. If you get this one, it is correct. Otherwise, it's wrong. You differentiate the sin cube theta by 3. When you differentiate sin cube theta by 3, 1 by 3 you keep aside. Sin cube theta means sin cube theta. Differentiation of sin cube theta by 3 means 1 by 3 you keep aside. Sin cube theta differentiation means 3 into 3 sin square theta into differentiation of sin theta is cos theta. 3 cancel. So sin square theta cos theta you will get from. That's why the integration of this one is equal to this one. We can write. Okay, now we substitute the values. That is equal to mr square by 2 into sin 90 means 1 minus sin 90 means 1 cube is 1 only by 3. 1 by 3. When you substitute the lower limits of sin minus pi by 2. Sin minus pi by 2 means minus 1 minus sin pi by 2. The sin for minus pi by 2 means minus 1 whole cube means minus 1. Minus or minus? Okay. You write minus 1 minus 1 by 3. Here, minus of, here sin minus pi by 2 means minus 1. Okay, minus of, minus 1 by 3 means you get plus 1 by 3, no? Plus 1 by 3. Therefore, that is equal to mr square by 2 into here 2 by 3, minus here 2 by 3, and here minus of, minus 2 by 3 means plus 2 by 3, no? Plus 2 by 3. Therefore, you will get I is equal to 2 by 3 to 4 by 3, 2 2s are, that means 2 by 3 to mr square, that means 2 mr square by 3, 2 mr square by 3. It is the moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about the diametric axis or about the natural axis. It is the moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about the diametric axis or about the natural axis of the hollow sphere, about the natural axis of the hollow sphere, okay. So, about the natural axis of the hollow sphere, the moment of inertia of the hollow sphere is Yeah, here 2/3 m square. Okay, this is correct. Next, in case of hollow sphere only, about the tangential axis, what is the moment of inertia? About the tangential axis, what is the moment of inertia? We have to derive. Okay, you have to remember this formula: 2/3 m square. About the natural axis or diametric axis of the hollow sphere, the moment of inertia is 2/3 m square. Okay. Okay. Next, about the diametric axis of the hollow sphere, what about the moment of inertia? Suppose this is the hollow sphere. It is the hollow sphere of radius capital R and mass capital M. Okay. About the diametric axis means you draw a tangential line. Sorry, not about diametric because previously we derived. No. About the tangential axis. About tangential axis. About the tangential axis. Tangential and diametric means this only. No. About the tangential axis, what is the moment of inertia? That is the case. Parallel to tangential axis, because it is tangent, no. So about this tangential axis, moment of inertia of this hollow sphere to be determined. So parallel to tangential axis, passing through the center of the hollow sphere. Parallel to tangential axis, passing through center mass and center of gravity of the sphere is this one. About this axis, moment of inertia, we know, just we derived. That is equal to 2/3 m square, no, in case of hollow sphere. Okay. Now we can apply the parallel axis theorem. According to parallel axis theorem, moment of inertia about this axis is equal to Ig plus m into perpendicular distance between two parallel axes is equal to capital R. Therefore, according to parallel axis theorem, okay, moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about the given axis is equal to Ig plus m into small r square. So Ig means about parallel to the given axis, passing through center mass and center gravity, moment of inertia of the hollow sphere is 2/3 m into r square plus m into square of the perpendicular distance between two parallel axes is equal to capital R, radius of the sphere, so m r square. So when you simplify them, then you will get, when you take LCM, you will get 5 m r square by 3. It is the moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about the tangential axis. Moment of inertia of the hollow sphere about the tangential axis. In this way, we can derive. Okay. You see, there are three identical spheres, hollow spheres, each of mass capital and radius capital. Each of mass capital and radius capital. All are identical. All are having same mass, all are having same radius also. M, M. And all are having same radius also. So, about this axis, this given axis. About this axis, what is the moment of inertia of the system? That is the question mark. About the given axis, that means about this axis, what is the moment of inertia of the given system of three hollow spheres? That is the question they asked. About this given axis, you see, this is the diametric axis for this hollow sphere, no? It is the tangent, this axis is the tangential axis for this sphere also, no? This is same for both these two spheres. Okay, that's why. So, moment of inertia of the entire system is equal to moment of inertia of this sphere. We have to add that. That is the answer. Moment of inertia of this sphere about this natural axis is equal to 2/3 m square, no? 2/3 m into r square. Plus, moment of inertia of this hollow sphere about the tangential axis equal just to be derived 5/3 into m r square. In this way, there are two spheres. This is tangential axis for this sphere also. That's why into 2 you write. Therefore, I is equal to 2/5 m² plus here 10/3 m² When you take LCM, then you, of course, here 2/3 only, no? Sorry, 2/3. It is 2/3 only, no? 2/3 m² plus 10/3 m². When you add them, that becomes 12/3 m². Therefore, I is equal to, we can write 4 m², no? 4 m². It is the moment of inertia of the system of three spheres, three hollow spheres about that axis, okay? About the same axis, what is the radius of variation of the three spheres, they may ask. That's why, about which axis they ask you the radius of variation, about that axis, you find the moment of inertia of the system. That is equal to this one. That is equal to, what about the radius of variation they ask you? Radius of variation is equal to effect total mass total mass of the system, mass of the system into radius of kinetic pi. Mass of entire system into radius of gyration square. Mass of the entire system, moment of inertia of the entire system is 4 mR square. No? That is called mass of the entire system is 3 m, because 3 spheres are there. So 3 m into radius of gyration square. Okay, therefore 4 cancel, mm cancel. Okay, 4 m cancel. No, sorry, get 3 m only. No, it is 3 m. Mass of the 3 sphere, mass of the system is only 3 m. Mass of the system is only 3 m. Therefore, mm cancel. So k square is equal to 4 r² / 3, or k is equal to √4r² / 3. That implies k is equal to 2r/√3. We can write now. So it is the radius of gyration of the system about this axis. In this way, we can find the radius of gyration. About this axis, what is the radius of gyration of the sphere means? That is equal to only one sphere is there, m into k square. K is equal to √5/3 r. No, you will get. In this way, we can find the radius of gyration also. Okay. Okay. In case of solid sphere, what is the moment of inertia about the natural axis? R diametric axis. Natural axis or diametric axis, both are same. Okay. Suppose here, it is the solid sphere like cricket ball or shot put. It is the solid sphere means like a cricket ball or shot put. Okay, here the radius is capital R, mass is capital R. It is the center O. The line passing through the center of the solid sphere is the natural axis or diametric axis. So about this axis, what is the moment of inertia of the solid sphere? We have to find. Okay. Here, as it is a solid sphere, when you divide this solid sphere into number of slices like this, each and every slice is like a circular disc. No? So we can imagine the solid sphere as the combination of number of circular discs. Number of circular discs. Okay. So here, you imagine one circular disc here. This is one circular disc. This is one circular disc. At here from the center, the circular disc is at a distance say y along y. Okay, of course this is equal to radius. This is equal to radius. And thickness in this direction, thickness is say d1. Thickness is d1. Okay, now here in case of solid sphere, the mass of the solid sphere distributes uniformly entire its volume. So this solid sphere is having volume mass density. Are simply density. So volume mass density. Volume mass density of the solid sphere. Rho is equal to mass by volume. Mass by volume of the solid sphere means 4/3 pi r³. That is equal to 3 m/4 pi r³. It is equation 1. It is the volume density of volume mass density or simply volume density of the solid sphere. Suppose the mass of the element considered here is the Yeah. It is the circular disc. It is the circular disc. The radius of the circular disc means that is say x. So radius of the circular disc, radius x is equal to, how we can write? Radius of the circular disc is equal to square root of r² - y² is equal to this one. No? So square root of r² - y² is the radius.
Okay, the radius of the element in the form of the disc, x is equal to square root of r² - y² because this is r and this is y. Okay, that's why this distance x is equal to by Pythagoras principle square root of r² - y² that is equal to x. Okay, now what is the mass of the element? If you know the mass of the this element in the form of the disc, then we can find the moment of inertia of the disc. So mass of the disc. Mass of disc. R element. Mass of the disc R element dm is equal to. Here, the volume density is known. So what is the volume of the this element we had considered. Volume into density gives mass, no? Volume into density. That gives mass of the element. So dm is equal to, what is the volume of the this disk? Here radius is x, so pi x square is the area of the disk. Here as the thickness is very small, the radius here and here at the top and bottom both are same. That's why pi x square is the area. Pi x square is the area into thickness is dy here. Thickness is dy. That gives volume of the disk into density. That means this one. So of course that is constant. So this is equal to pi rho x square. Mean x square means of course later we'll substitute x square into dy. Okay, x square into dy. And this is equation 3. Therefore, moment of inertia of the element, or moment of inertia of this disk element in the form of a disk about this natural axis is equal to, as this is the axis passing through center and perpendicular to plane of this elemental disk, no? Okay, that's why moment of inertia is ma square by 2. That means mass of the element dm into radius square and x square by ma square by 2 means by 2. Okay, this is equal to mass of the element means you substitute this one, pi rho x square into dy into x square whole by 2. Okay, therefore total moment of inertia of the entire solid sphere. So this type here, the entire solid sphere can be imagined as the combination of number of this type of elemental disks from this position to this position. Okay, that means y value changes from, actually it is zero. From the, suppose if you take this as the origin, from origin up to plus r, here up to minus r. So here x is equal to minus r, x is equal to plus r, sorry, y is equal to minus r, y is equal to plus r. Y value changes from plus r, minus r to plus r. So y is equal to minus r to y is equal to plus r. If it is taken as the origin, we can imagine this type of element, this type of elemental disks. That's why between y is equal to minus r to plus r, if you integrate this one, that gives the moment of inertia of all the elemental disks considered from y is equal to minus r to plus r. Therefore, total moment of inertia of the entire solid sphere, I is equal to, okay, integral dI. Okay, this is equal to integral pi rho x square into this x square means x to the power of 4, we can write now, x to the power of 4 into dy by 2. Pi rho x to the power of 4 dy by 2. Here limits y is equal to minus r to plus r. Okay. Therefore, here I is equal to pi rho is constant, pi rho by 2 is constant, you write outside. Pi rho by 2 is constant, you write outside. Integral x to the power of 4. What about x value? You substitute here. From equation 2, you see. From equation 2, square root of r square minus y square is there, no? Whole to the power of 4. That means r square minus y square whole to the power of 1 by 2 by whole to the power of 4 means 4 by 2. That means 2 you will get into dy. Just x to the power of 4 means x is equal to this one, or x square is equal to r square minus y square. X to the power of 4 means r square minus y square whole square, no? Into dy. Already pi rho by 2 I have written here. Okay, now you expand this one. So I is equal to pi rho by 2 into integral. Here y is equal to minus r to y is equal to plus r. Okay. So expand this one, a minus b whole square. R to the power of 4 plus y to the power of 4 minus 2 r square y square into dy. Okay, this is equal to pi rho by 2 into, you integrate them, r to the power of 4 into dy. Integral r to the power of 4 into dy means r to the power of 4 is constant into dy means y after integration, plus y to the power of 5 by 5. Minus 2 r square into y, integral y square dy means y cube by 3 we can write. Limits minus r to plus r. So here therefore this is equal to, I is equal to pi by 2 into density means 3m by 4 pi r cube we can write. 3m by 4 pi r cube. So yeah, here you substitute the limits. Later you substitute plus y to prop 5 by 5 minus 2 r square y cube by 3. Substitute the limits minus r to plus r. Minus r to plus r. Okay, when you simplify them, then you will get I is equal to 2 by 5 m r square. This is the moment of inertia of the solid sphere about that is the moment of inertia of the solid sphere about the natural axis or about the diametric axis. In case of hollow sphere, we got 2 by 3. Here, 2 by 5 m r square. Okay. In case of hollow sphere, moment of inertia about the natural axis is equal to, we got 2 by 3 m r square. Here, it is 2 by 5 m r square. Okay. Now, moment of inertia of the solid sphere about tangential axis, any tangential axis. Suppose it is the solid sphere and it is the center of the solid sphere. Okay, about the tangential axis means you draw a tangent to the solid sphere here. It is the tangential axis. About this tangential axis, what is the moment of inertia? We have to find. That is our aim. Mass of the solid sphere is a capital M and radius is a radius capital R. Okay, so here in case of solid sphere, the center mass, in case of uniform solid sphere, center mass lies at the center only. No, here it is the center. Okay, now parallel to this given axis, passing through center mass, we can imagine one axis. No, we can imagine one axis here. Parallel to the given axis and passing through center mass or center of gravity, we can imagine one axis. About this axis already, just we derived the formula for moment of inertia. That is Ig. Ig is equal to, we got in case of solid sphere, 2 by 5 mr square. No? Okay, now here the distance, perpendicular distance between these two parallel axes, we know. Perpendicular distance between two parallel axes is equal to radius of the solid sphere only. That's why you apply the parallax theorem. According to parallel axis theorem. Okay, moment of inertia about this given axis is equal to moment of inertia about the parallel axis passing through center of gravity and product of mass of the solid sphere into square of the distance between the two axes. Okay, so this is equal to Ig means 2 by 5 mr square plus m into r means the distance between these two, small r is equal to capital R. Okay, so capital R square. Therefore, I is equal to, we will get, when you take LCM, you will get 7 mr square by 5. 7 mr square by 5. So it is the moment of inertia of the solid sphere about any tangential axis. Okay, next, C. Moment of inertia about the card. Already I said, according to that we can do. Okay. Suppose there are two identical solid spheres. Like this. Here this is the tangential axis. Here it is the common tangent. About this common tangent, what is the moment of inertia of the system? They may ask. Here mass of the two solid spheres are same and radii are also same. For both. Okay. Then what is the moment of inertia of these two solid spheres about this axis? If they ask, then I is equal to, suppose here one more disc is also there here. We can imagine one more disc also. Another identical disc like this. So here it is also having same mass m. It is also having same mass m and radius. It is also capital R. All are solid spheres. Okay. Now moment of inertia of the all solid sphere about this axis. Here this is the tangential axis for these two solid spheres, but it is the natural axis for the solid sphere. No. So first you find the moment of inertia of the these two solid spheres as this axis acts as the tangential axis. That means this case only. That's why for this solid sphere, moment of inertia is as it is tangential axis for the solid sphere, then moment of inertia about the tangential axis, this only know. So 7/5 mr square. Okay, in this way there are two identical solid spheres are there. That's why into two directly we can write. Suppose if they are different, then we have to write the formulas for moment of inertia about the tangential axis separately, and we have to add them. Plus, it is the natural axis for the solid sphere. That's why moment of inertia is 2/5 mr square. No, just now we derived previously 2/5 mr square. Therefore, this is equal to I is equal to when you add. You see. 14 mr square by 5, 2 mr square by 5. That means 16 mr square by 5. No, 16 mr square by 5. It is the moment of inertia of the system of three solid spheres. It is the moment of inertia of the system of three solid spheres. Okay, 16 mr square by 5. 16 mr square by 5. What is the radius of gyration of the system? What is the radius of gyration of the system about this axis? So about this axis, if they ask to find the radius of gyration, so what is the radius of gyration? Radius of gyration. Already I said radius of gyration means effective distance of all bodies from the axis of rotation, or effective distance of all the particles in a rigid body from the axis of rotation. That is called radius of gyration. So in this case, what is the radius of gyration? So about which axis they ask the radius of gyration? About that axis, first you find the moment of inertia, then make them equal to mk square. M means mass of the entire system. So therefore I is equal to 16 mr square by 5. We got that is equal to mass of the system. That means whose moment of inertia is measured here, that system mass into radius of gyration square. Therefore 16 mr square by 5 is equal to mass of the system. Means as the two solid spheres are, three solid spheres are there, total mass of the system is 3 into capital M into k square. Here m cancel. Okay, therefore k square is equal to 16 r square by 15. We can write implies k is equal to 4 r by root 15. We can write, no, 4 r by root 15. That is the radius of gyration of the three solid spheres about this axis, given axis. Okay, so in this way we can find the radius of gyration also. Okay, you see, moment in case of rectangular plane lamina, that means the plane sheet in the form of rectangular plate or lamina, plane sheet is also called as the lamina. Okay, that's why rectangular plane lamina it is, having length L, breadth B, mass M. It is the midpoint. Okay, now about an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to length. Here this is the length, no, passing through midpoint and perpendicular to length lies within the plane of the lamina, lies within perpendicular to length and lies within the plane, lies within the plane. That is also important, within the plane. Lies within the plane. That means here the plane sheet lies within the plane of the board. Axis also lies within the plane of the board only. That means the axis lies within the plane of the lamina and perpendicular to length, passing through midpoint. About this axis, what is the moment of inertia? Here actually it is just like, suppose if you imagine this as a thin rod, about an axis passing through midpoint perpendicular length, what is the formula for moment of inertia? ML square by 12. So here also formula is same, ML square by 12 only. We can imagine like that. Okay, so otherwise you take a small element here, you take a small element, you take a small element having thickness width dx at a distance x from the axis. Then suppose the mass of this element is say dm. Actually the mass of the plate distributes entire its area, no, surface area, no. Okay, that's why it is having surface density. So what is the surface density? Surface density sigma is equal to mass by area of the plate, means length into breadth, no. Area of the plate is length into breadth. Okay, therefore, mass of the element considered, mass of the element is equal to sigma into, that means mass per unit area into area of this element. Length is b, breadth is dx. That's why b into dx. Okay, this is equal to sigma means m by lb into b into dx. Of course, bb cancel. That is equal to m by m by l into dx. It is the mass of the element. Okay, here you see every part of the element is equidistant from the axis of rotation. That's why this entire mass can be treated as a point mass, and due to that moment of inertia about this axis. So moment of inertia of the element dA is equal to mass of the element considered into distance square simply. So x square. Because each and every part of the element is equidistant from the axis. That's why we can imagine this element as a point mass. And what is the moment of inertia of that point mass about this axis means dm into distance square. We can write like this. So dm means already we have m by l into dx. M by l into dx. Okay, therefore, from this formula, I is equal to, okay, here this is equal to dm means m by l into dx into x square is there, no? Therefore, m by l into x square dx, that is the moment of inertia of the element. Okay, therefore, moment of inertia of the entire plate or rectangle lamina is equal to integral dA limits. This type of elements can be imagined from here. See, it is the origin. This type of elements can be imagined from this side is L by 2, this side is L by 2. So from this origin towards left, x is equal to minus L by 2, x is equal to minus L by 2. Here x is equal to plus L by 2. We can write now x is equal to plus L by 2. So x is equal to from minus L by 2 to x is equal to plus L by 2 integrate. This is equal to integral dI means m by l into x square dx. So this is equal to m by l, you write outside. Integral x square dx means we can write x cube by 3 limits minus l by 2 to plus l by 2. Minus l by 2 to plus l by 2. Okay, this is equal to, therefore, m by l into, of course, m by l into l by 2 whole cube means l cube by L 8, that means L cube by 8 into 3 means 24 you will get. When you substitute lower limit, you had put minus sign, minus of, here also, minus L by 2 whole cube means minus L cube by 8, by 3 means into 4, 3. That's why minus L cube by 24. You will get like this. Okay, therefore, when you simplify them, then you will get M. Here, L cube by 24 plus L cube by 24 means L cube by 12. 2L cube by 24 means L cube by 12. 1L, L cancel. So ML square by 12. So ML square by 12. This is the moment of inertia of the rectangular plate about an axis passing through midpoint perpendicular to its length and lies within the plane of the plate. It is similar to the moment of inertia of the uniform rod passing through midpoint and perpendicular to its length. No? So here also we can use the same formula. Similarly, the moment of inertia of the about an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to breadth, that means about this axis. Same here, as this axis is perpendicular to length, we have ml square by 12. If it is perpendicular to breadth, we have to write mb square by 12. Okay, so about this axis, you see, suppose this is the rectangular plate. It is the rectangular plate. Okay, now about this axis here. It is the length L and it is breadth B. Okay, so about this axis, what is the moment of inertia? Okay, that means this axis is perpendicular to its breadth. If it is parallel to breadth and lies within the, here already we derived moment of inertia about this axis passing through midpoint perpendicular to length and lies within the plane of the lamina is equal to ml square by 12. If the same axis but passing through midpoint lies within the plane of the lamina perpendicular to breadth, then we will get moment of inertia I is equal to mb square by 12. Same, mb square by 12. Okay, suppose if the axis passing through the midpoint and perpendicular to plane of the rectangular lamina about an axis. About an axis. Okay, of course, I will draw here. Okay, you see, it is the rectangular plane lamina, uniform plane lamina of length L, breadth B. Mass, say, capital M. Mass of the lamina is capital M. Okay. About an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to plane of the lamina, rectangle, perpendicular to plane of the rectangular lamina. That means about this axis, we need the moment of inertia. Here you see, suppose here this plane, rectangular plane lamina lies in XY plane. XY plane. The length is parallel to X axis and breadth is parallel to Y axis. And the Z axis here, this given axis about which moment of inertia to be determined lies along Z axis. And midpoint lies exactly at the origin C. Now, the moment of inertia about an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to breadth. Perpendicular to breadth means that is Ix. Moment of inertia of the plane lamina about an axis passing through midpoint lies within the plane of the lamina and perpendicular to breadth means that is Ix. No? So that Ix is equal to already just we derived mv square by 12. Okay, next, moment of inertia of the same plane lamina about an axis passing through midpoint lies within the plane of the lamina and perpendicular to this length or parallel to breadth, that is Iy. Iy is equal to already we derived just now, so ml square by 12. Okay, now we apply the perpendicular axis theorem because these two axes lies within the plane of the lamina but perpendicular to each other. This is the axis passing through intersection of the two points perpendicular to plane of the lamina. Okay, that's why about this axis, in order to find the moment of inertia, we can apply the perpendicular axis theorem. No? From perpendicular axis theorem. From perpendicular axis theorem. Perpendicular axis theorem. Perpendicular axis theorem. Okay, so Iz is equal to Ix plus Iy. XY axis lies within the plane of the lamina and Z axis is perpendicular to plane of the lamina passing through intersection of the two perpendicular axes. Okay, the about this axis moment of inertia is of course Iz is equal to I only, no? Iz is equal to I. Okay, I, that is equal to Ix means mv square by 12. Mv square by 12 plus Iy means ml square by 12. Therefore, I is equal to m, you take common m of L square plus B square by 12, we can write now. If breadth is negligible, then it is equal to ML square by 12 only. Okay. So this is the moment of inertia of the rectangular plane lamina about an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to its plane. Now, moment of inertia of the square plane lamina, we have to obtain. Same, but L is equal to B there. So in case of square lamina, square plane lamina. In this case, first, in this case, first case, here you see, it is the square lamina of side say A or say L. Of course, as a square lamina, here also L. Okay. Here, this is the midpoint. This is X axis, this is Y axis. Okay. About this X axis or about this Y axis, moment of inertia. It is say Ix, it is say Iy. Okay. But about here, about the X axis means about line passing through midpoint lies within the plane of the plane of the square sheet. About an axis passing through midpoint lies within the plane but along X, Y axis. Both are identical, no? About this axis or about this axis, the square plate is symmetrical. That's why moment of inertia is same. That's why Ix is equal to Iy. What about that one? Ix is equal to Iy. That is equal to how much? Here you see, here this is the axis perpendicular to this one. This is the axis perpendicular to this one. Okay. Perpendicular to this, of course, this side. As length and breadth both are same, length and breadth both are same, then we can write ix is equal to iy, that is equal to m into this l square, m into l square by 12 we can write now, because this is side. If it is b square by 12, if as it is l, ml square by 12 we can write. Okay, next, about an axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular plane of the sheet. That means suppose this is a rectangular sheet. This is the rectangular sheet. About this axis passing through midpoint and perpendicular to its plane, what is the moment of inertia? What is the moment of inertia? Okay, here it is x axis. Moment of inertia is ix about this axis. It is y axis. About this axis, moment of inertia iy. It is z axis. So about z axis, what is the moment of inertia? Iz is equal to question mark. Okay, iz is equal to I. That is equal to, that means moment of inertia of the square lamina about an axis passing through midpoint perpendicular to its plane is equal to, according to perpendicular axis theorem, just as here, ix plus iy. That implies I is equal to ix plus iy, means both are same, ml square by 12 plus ml square by 12. That means ml square by 6 you will get, no? So ml square by 6 you write. This is the formula in case of square lamina. Okay. Okay, moment of inertia of uniform solid cone about natural axis. Natural axis means that is the line passing through center of the base and through vertex. That is called natural axis of the solid cone. Here mass of the solid cone is a capital M. Radius of the base is capital R. Height of the cone is a small h. Then what is the density here? What is the density of the cone? What about the density of the cone? Density means volume density. Volume, because the mass of this cone is distributed entire its volume uniformly. That's why it is having volume density. So volume density, rho is equal to mass by volume of the cone, means 1/3 pi r square h, you know? 1/3 pi r square h. In basic mathematics, we discussed it. Okay, that is equal to 3m by pi r square h. It is the density of the, it is the density of the solid cone, density of the solid cone, mass by volume. Okay, so this is the equation one. It is equation one. Okay, now in order to find the moment of inertia of this solid cone, you imagine it is not point mass. That's why to find the moment of inertia of the solid cone, you imagine this solid cone as is the combination of number of thin disks. Because you imagine this cone, you divide this cone into number of slices like this. Then each slice is in the form of a disk. You imagine such a disk, one disk you imagine here. This is one such disk. Okay. From, suppose this is, take the vertex as the origin. From this origin, it is at a distance, say y. It is at a distance y. Okay, radius of the disk considered here is elemental disk, that is say x. Okay, thickness, as this thickness is along y axis, along y direction, that's why you take the thickness as dy. Mass of the element is say dm. Mass of the element is say dm. So how we can find the mass of the element? Mass of the element dm is equal to volume of the element into density we can write now. Volume of the element means, you see, as this elemental disk is a circle, elemental disk means it is a circle, the area is pi x square into thickness dy, that gives volume. Okay, so pi x square into thickness dy, that gives volume, into density gives mass. Okay, therefore from this formula, this is dm. You say this is equation two. Okay, but we had obtained the value in terms of y. X should not be there. X should not be there. Suppose this angle is say theta. Semi-vertex angle of the cone is say theta. Then from the diagram, you take tan theta. Tan theta is equal to, in this triangle, opposite side by adjacent means x by y. We can write. Or you take this triangle. Okay. Opposite for this triangle, opposite side is capital R and adjacent is equal to h. That's why capital R by h we can write. Capital R by h we can write. You eliminate x value. So therefore, from this x is equal to, we can write R by h into y we can write. Okay, now you substitute this from 3, x value you substitute in 2. So 3 into dm is equal to, actually we are having formula pi rho x square into dy. Pi rho x square dy. So this is equal to pi rho into x square means R square y square by h square into dy. Okay, this is equal to pi constant, rho constant, R square constant, h constant. That means even you imagine that it is the combination of number of disks. Any disk you consider, these values does not change. Only when you consider the number of disks, this y value changes, x value changes. Here only y is there. Y is the variable here. Into h square into pi rho R square by h square into y square dy. This is the mass of the elemental disk considered here. Okay. Therefore, moment of inertia of the elemental disk about this axis means this is axis passing through midpoint of the center of the disk and perpendicular to its plane. That means it is a natural axis for elemental disk. So moment of inertia of the elemental disk about its natural axis di is equal to mr square by 2, no, dm, mass of the element dm into radius square means x square mr square by 2. Okay, this is equal to dm means you substitute this one, pi rho r square by h square into y square dy into x square. X means this one, r square y square by h square by 2 is there. That means into 1 by 2. Okay, therefore when you simplify them, you see here pi rho into r square into r square, r to power of 4 we can write, by h square into h square, h to power of 4, 2 is there. So 2 h to power of 4 we can write. Okay, pi rho r to power of 4, h to power of 4 into 2 we have written. Then remaining is y to power of 4 dy. So y to power of 4 dy we can write. This is di. Okay, this is the moment of inertia of the only elemental disk about this axis. Okay, therefore, in order to obtain the total moment of inertia of the entire solid cone, this type of elements can be imagined from y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h, no? Here, y is equal to h here, y is equal to 0 here. Because element is considered at a distance y. So this type of elements can be imagined from vertex to base. That's why y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h. We can imagine this type of elemental disks. That's why to obtain the total moment of inertia for each and every element, you find the moment of inertia and you add them. Instead of doing so, for one element, you find the moment of inertia about this axis and you do integration between y is equal to 0 to h. Okay, therefore, total moment of inertia is equal to integral di, integral moment of inertia of the elemental disk here between the limits y is equal to 0 to h. So this is equal to integral di means this one, pi rho r to power of 4 by 2 into h to power of 4 into y to power of 4 dy. This is equal to pi rho r to power of 4 by 2 h to power of 4. That is constant, you write outside. Integral y to power of 4 dy means we can write y to power of 5 by 5 after integration. Limits 0 to h. Now we substitute the data. Pi r to power of 4 by 2 h to power of 4 into, what about density? Density is equal to, we substitute, already we have density, no? 3m by pi r square h. 3m by pi r square into h into, when you substitute upper limit here, when you substitute pi r to power of 4 by 2 h to power of 4 into density means this one, into when you substitute upper limit, you will get h to power of 5 by 5. When you substitute lower limit, it becomes 0. Okay, minus 0. Here, h to the power of 4 into h, h to the power of 5. This h to the power of 5 will be cancelled. Okay, pi cancel. Then remaining is, moment of inertia, I is equal to, here you see, 3m, Here r square, here r, one r square cancels, so remaining r square. So 3m r square by 2 into 5 means 10. No? So moment of inertia of the solid cone about this its natural axis is equal to 3m r square by 10. That is the moment of inertia of the solid cone, 3m r square by 10, where m is the mass of the cone, solid cone, and r is the radius of the base of the solid cone. So in this way we can derive the formula for moment of inertia of the solid cone. Similarly, moment of inertia of the hollow cone also we can find by the same method. A hollow cone means here, when you imagine that hollow cone has the number of elements, each element behaves like a ring, uniform ring. Okay, about one elemental ring, you find the moment of inertia about the natural axis. Okay, then you here how you can find the mass of the elemental ring, that is important. Mass given to the elemental ring distributes only on its surface. Only on its surface. That's why surface density you consider and find the mass of the elemental ring. Then moment of inertia of the elemental ring about this axis you find and integrate between y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h. Then you will get answer. Okay. Okay, next, moment of inertia of the uniform hollow cone about natural axis. Okay, here. Moment of inertia of the uniform hollow cone, that means mass of the hollow cone is distributed entire its surface uniformly. That's why it is the uniform hollow cone. Okay, so first you imagine the cone. Hollow cone it is. Okay, this is the center and it is the vertex about natural axis. About natural axis of the hollow cone, what is the moment of inertia? That is our aim. Okay, so your mass of the cone is say capital M, radius of the cone is capital R, radius of base of the cone is capital R, and height of the cone small h. Okay, so here, so how we can find the surface density of the cone?
In this case, height of the cone is h and the radius is capital R. Okay. In order to find the moment of inertia of the uniform hollow cone, first, the mass of this entire hollow cone distributes uniformly over its surface only. That's why it is having surface density. So, surface density of the cone. Surface density of cone. Sigma is equal to mass by surface area. Suppose the length of the inclined surface is say L. This is length of the inclined surface, that is say L. Then sigma is equal to what is the area of the this curved surface, because mass lies on the curved surface only. That's why area of the curved surface means we can write pi r L. No? Pi r L. Area of the curved surface is pi r L. So area of the curved surface is pi r L, which is equal to M by pi into r into here in terms of okay, keep like this pi r l only, keep like this pi r l. This is the equation 1, because all are constant, surface density is constant. Okay, now in order to find the moment of inertia, we can imagine this cone as a combination of number of slices. No, every slice appears like a ring. Every slice appears like a ring here. Okay, suppose the elemental ring is considered. Elemental ring is considered. Suppose this vertex has the origin. Elemental ring is considered at a distance y, and the radius of the element considered here is say small x. Okay, here actually width means we can take width this one, but here the mass of the this cone lies only on the surface. That's why we have to consider this length. This has the width, that is say dr. That has the width, which is dr. Therefore, mass of the elemental ring, m is equal to surface density, that means mass per unit area, into area of the element, dA. That is called sigma into, because it is constant, keep like this only. Finally, we can substitute. Area of the element means circumference is equal to 2 pi x. Circumference is equal to 2 pi x into width is dr. 2 pi x into dr. Okay. So what about dr? You see, just you see the component of this dl along this direction. This here, this vertical width of the element is a dy. Okay, how we can write in terms of dy? Here you see, this is dl and this is dy. So I am drawing this part only. Here this part is like this. This part is like, it is dl, it is dy. This angle means that is equal to semi-vertex angle only, no? So here semi-vertex angle is theta. Semi-vertex angle is theta. This angle. Semi-vertex angle is theta. That's why here this is theta. Okay, then you take cos theta. Cos theta is equal to dy by dl. Or dl is equal to, we can write dy into secant theta, we can write, no? That's why this is equal to sigma into 2 pi x into dl means dy secant theta, we can write dy secant theta. Okay, but from the diagram, this is set 2. From the diagram, we had to obtain only, we have converted to only one variable, because as long as the number of elements are considered here, x value changes, y value also changes. That's why, but theta does not change, it is constant. Here, x value, y value, both are variables. So we have converted them into only single variable. So we have eliminated the x value from the diagram. From diagram, you take tan theta. Tan theta is equal to x by y. We can write opposite by adjacent, we can write. You take this triangle, tan theta is equal to r by this h, we can write, no? R by h, opposite by adjacent. So from this, that implies x is equal to r y by h. Now you substitute this 3, from 3, x value into 3 into gives dm is equal to mass of the elemental ring is equal to sigma into 2 pi x into x we have substitute, no? X we have to substitute 2 pi into x means r y by h, okay, instead of x only I substituted, into dy secant theta, dy secant theta. So therefore mass of the elemental ring is equal to, you write all constants aside, 2 pi sigma is constant, secant theta is also constant, secant theta is also constant, okay, into 2 pi sigma secant theta, r is also constant, r, you write r also here, you better to write here. Here, 2 pi sigma is constant, r is constant, secant theta is constant, okay, by h is also constant, into y dy are the variables. So, we have written all or not, 2 pi sigma r secant theta by h into y dy, okay. This is the mass of the elemental ring considered. Okay, therefore, moment of inertia of the elemental ring about this axis means that is the natural axis. Okay, so this is the axis passing through the center of the ring and perpendicular to its plane. So moment of inertia of the elemental ring about the natural axis is equal to as it is the circular ring about the natural axis means mr square only, know that means dm into mass of the element into radius square. Radius of the element is x, that's why x square. You write. Okay, now from this di is equal to mass of the element means already you write this one, 2 pi sigma r secant theta by h into y dy into x square means x is equal to r y by h, no? So whole square, that means r y by h whole square. So therefore d I is equal to, again you write the constant as a 2 pi sigma is constant, no doubt. Here r square, that means r cube, okay, into secant theta is constant already, y into y square, that means y cube into dy by h into h square, that means h cube, right here. Therefore, total moment of inertia, this type of elements can you imagine from y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h, no? So integrate moment of inertia of the element about this axis between the limits y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h. Then you will get the third moment of inch of the cone. So integral di between the limits y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h. This is equal to, while writing the, while doing the integration here, as these are constants we write outside, 2 pi sigma r cube secant theta by h cube. You write outside into integral y cube dy. Y is equal to 0 to y is equal to h. So this is equal to 2 pi sigma r cube secant theta by h cube into y cube integration means y to power of 4 by 4. That is equal to 0 to h. Now we substitute the data. I is equal to 2 pi sigma means m by pi r l m by pi r l into r cube by h cube into secant theta. Secant theta means already we are having from the diagram. How we can write cos theta? Cos theta is equal to, you see, from this right angle triangle, cos theta is equal to adjacent means h by hypotenuse means l. H by l you write. H by l. Sorry. Cos theta is equal to h by l. Secant theta means l by h, no? So you write secant theta. Secant theta means l by h. Secant theta is equal to l by h. Since secant theta is equal to l by h. Okay. Into, when you substitute the limits, you will get h power of 4 by 4. Okay, minus 0. When you substitute the limit, it becomes 0. You forget that. So here, h power of 4, h power of 4 cancel. L, L cancel. Pi, pi cancel. 2, 2's are. So when you simplify them, you will have r, 1 r cancel. So r square is remainder. So mr square by 2 we have. Mr square by 2. It is the moment of inertia. Hollow cone about its natural axis. So moment of inertia of the hollow cone about the natural axis is this one. Okay. In this way, we can do the, we can find the moment of inertia of the hollow cone also. Okay. These are the different cases in which moment of inertia for different regular bodies we have determined. Okay.